In this graph, we'll look at lifetime gonadotropin secretion patterns. And these are the hormones FSH and LH, follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone from the anterior pituitary, that help to regulate the gonad production of sex steroids, as well as their activity and production of gametes, at least in the post-puberty period. Now, those two hormones are stimulated by GnRH from the hypothalamus, the gonadotropin-releasing hormone. And we're going to get these sort of cyclic waves of the secretion of these hormones over time. And so we're going to start here in the fetal period, right, pre-birth. And what we find is that as the brain develops, that GnRH secretion will go up. That will stimulate spike in FSH and LH secretion. That will aid the activity of the gonads in producing the sex steroids, which are helping to determine the phenotype, the masculinization or feminization of the genital tract. And so we end up sort of looking more like male or more like female based upon this increased activity of that hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis. Now, late in pregnancy here, we see a drop off. We get placental steroids that are feeding back negatively, quite strongly, on those hormones. Post-birth, of course, we lose that placental feedback of those sex steroids, right? The placenta actually produces some of the sex steroids. But when we lose that, our negative feedback of GnRH and therefore FSH and LH has disappeared in this period immediately post-birth. We're going to get this enormous spike again in our gonadotropin hormones. This causes this sort of like this mini puberty to occur very early in infancy, in months to the first couple of years. This further enhances reproductive tract development, feminization or masculinization of the brain itself, how we view ourselves as male or female. That'll be followed by this prolonged period in childhood where there's very little activity, there's no reproductive function. And then, largely genetically determined, we're going to get an increase in our GnRH and therefore FSH and LH in a pulsatile fashion, the release being pulsatile, that's going to initiate puberty. And again, so now we're really going to activate the development of secondary sex characteristics. We're going to slowly become reproductively active as those structures become mature and producing the gametes, the eggs, oocytes, and the sperm, sort of late in puberty here. But then we see a divergence here between the secretion in male on the bottom and the secretion in female at the top here. And that's largely because the females are much more pulsatile during their reproductive adult phase. That's largely because they go through a much more cyclic activity of their reproductive function, where they're fertile and functionally reproductive, and then they aren't, and then they transition back. And so we'll talk more about that later. In males, we're going to get basically a continual production of the gametes, the sperm, over time for decades, and it's much less cyclic in nature. Now, at about 50 years of age, the gonads start to produce less of the sex steroids. In females, that's much more dramatic. They go through what's called menopause. The ovarian steroids fall off dramatically. However, you see that the gonadotropin hormones here, the FSH and LH, rise dramatically. And that's because of that loss of negative feedback, the same exact effect we saw down here when we lost that placental feedback post-birth. This happens at menopause, and so we get a very large increase in the secretion of FSH, LH, GnRH. It's not really doing anything because our gonads are no longer active. We'll finally get a tailing off here in late adulthood during senescence. That's just a period of deterioration with advanced age. In males, we get sort of the same thing. The testosterone production by the gonads goes down, and so our gonadotropin release would go up. Less negative feedback, and the same sort of tailing off over time as we get quite old.